नमस्ते, अस्सलाम, सत श्री अकाल, वणक्कम, केम छो एंड व्हाट्सअप। टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग ऑन नोडल एनालिसिस। दिस इज अ वेरी 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 इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एज फार एज गेट पेट्रोलियम इज कंसर्न्ड। सो विदाउट वेस्टिंग एनी टाइम लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड विद द प्रेजेंटेशन। First of all, we will be discussing on petroleum production system. Okay. For a petroleum production system, there are basically a reservoir, wellbore, tubing, wellhead, and separator. All right. So in other words, we can say that we can divide the entire system into three components. First component, which comprises of a reservoir and the wellbore and the bottom hole. Second component, which comprises of the tubing and the wellhead. And the third component, that is from the flow line to the separator. Okay, so we can divide it into three components, right? So as we all know, the fluid from the reservoir will first reach here, that is to the bottom hole. Okay, from bottom hole it will go through the tubing to the wellhead, and from the wellhead it will go to the flow line, and from flow line it will go to the separator. Okay, it's a basic flow. All right. Okay, now coming to this diagram, see, this is a more intricate diagram. This given in more detail. Okay, whatever I discussed, this is a simple representation of our production system. Okay, now let's see where the pressure losses occur in the production system. Okay, now again, our journey of the flow begins from the reservoir, point one. It then goes to the bottom hole, point two. It then travels through this tubing, point three. It reaches the wellhead, point four. It from the flow line, that is point five, it reaches to the separator. Okay, all right. Now what? Now the reservoir is denoted by PR. The reservoir pressure is denoted by PR. The flowing sand phase pressure, that is at this point, the flowing sand phase pressure is denoted by PWFS. The flowing bottom hole pressure, that is at this point, it is represented by PWF, or commonly known as FBHP. This is also known as FBHP. PUR, which is the upstream. Let's say there is a restriction over here, alright? So upstream of the restriction, PUR, and downstream of the restriction, it is PUD, PDR, alright? Now let's say there is a safety valve. Okay, let's say there is a safety valve over here. This can be a triple SV, that is subsurface safety valve. All right. The upstream of the subsurface safety valve is denoted by PUSV, and downstream of the safety valve is represented by PDSV. Okay. From that, the flow will go to the wellhead. So this point, this wellhead, the wellhead pressure is denoted by PWH. From wellhead, it then goes to the downstream surface choke. Okay, see, there is a choke over here, PDSC. There is a surface choke over here. Okay, and from surface choke via flow line, it will go to the separator, where the pressure is denoted by PS. All right. Now this is the fluid flow in the production system. Okay. Now there would be definitely, let's say there is a reservoir at 2000. PSI pressure, all right. Okay, and there is a separator at, let's say, 100 PSI pressure, all right. Now what does this mean? That means when the fluid takes the journey from the reservoir, it begins from 2000, and after traveling from the bottom hole to the surface, when it reaches till the separator, the fluid pressure would be 100 psi. That means there would be pressure losses encountered while this journey. Okay, now we need to address these pressure losses also. Okay, now let's see where the pressure losses occur. Okay, when the fluid flow from the reservoir to the surface. Now, the very first point of the pressure loss is this one, delta P1. See, delta P1. Okay, this loss occurs in the porous media. That means this particular pressure loss, that is delta P1, occurs in the reservoir. Okay, second pressure loss, that is second pressure loss, that is delta P2, delta P2, it occurs across the completion, or that is at the well bone, at the well bone, bottom hole, at the bottom hole, delta P2 will be occurred. And after that there will be delta P3. This is due to a down a bottom hole restriction. Okay, this is delta P3, the pressure loss because of the restriction, bottom hole restriction. Then there will be delta P4, that is because of triple SV which we installed. Triple SV, again, it is used for a safety device, and in offshore it is compulsory to have a triple SV. In onshore I don't think it is a compulsion, but in offshore definitely we require a triple SV. It belongs because it is concerned with the health, it is concerned with the HSE norms of offshore. Now, so delta P4 is done. Now delta P5, that is the loss across choke. Okay, this delta P5, because this pressure loss is occurring across the choke that we installed at the surface. Now, next there will be delta P6. Okay, this delta P6, that is loss in the downstream. That is, this delta P6 occurs from the in the flow line, that is between the wellhead to the separator. Whatever distance of flow line we have, delta P6 occurs over there. That is loss at the downstream. All right. Okay. Now we can summarize this pressure loss into three parts. That is, this particular portion, that is total loss in the reservoir and the completion. Let me denote it with different color, with blue color. Okay, this we can say that as one delta P, that is the reservoir pressure loss, that is the pressure loss between the reservoir and the well bore, that is between the reservoir and the completion. Okay, this is the delta P1. I'm just denoting it in a bigger picture. All right, so this is one set of pressure loss. Second set of pressure loss occurs in the tubing. Okay, that is till the till PWH, till wellhead, the second set of pressure loss occurs. Okay, and the third set of pressure loss occurs at the surface. This is the third set, that is from the choke to the separator. So that's the third set of pressure loss. Okay, so from this we can say that there are three set of pressure loss. First, that is in the reservoir, first pressure loss which occurs from the reservoir to the completion. Second set of pressure loss which occurs across the tubing, and third set of pressure loss which occurs across the surface choke and separator. All right. Yeah, this I have graphically shown this particular thing, the same thing that I have mentioned over here. So this is the plot is between pressure versus the position. Okay. Now, as we all know, the journey of our fluid begins from here, reservoir. Boundary pressure, let's say it begin from 2000 psi pressure. Okay, and once and during the journey till it reaches the separator, the pressure of the fluid will be at 100 psi. The system pressure will be 100 psi. Okay, so let's see where does the pressure loss occurs. So from the reservoir boundary to the sand face, see, this amount of pressure loss has occurred. From the sand face to well bore, this much. From the tubing, there's a restriction. All right, pressure loss, safety valve pressure loss. This pressure loss occurred between the tubing and the safety valve. From the safety valve to the wellhead, this amount of pressure has been lost. From the choke, in the choke, across the choke, this amount of pressure loss has occurred. And from the flow line to the separator, this amount of pressure loss occurred. Okay, one thing that you can note very clearly, that if the size of the restriction is very small, okay, see. For example, you can see that over here, that is tubing restriction or the safety valve, or this, see this thing, choke. Okay, as we all know, the choke sizes maybe 12 by 60, 64, 16 by 64 or 20 by 64. Okay, this is inch. 1 by 64 is the inch in 1 by 64. Okay, this is the unit of the choke. Okay. Alright. So, you can see very clearly that wherever there is a restriction being created, at that point the pressure loss would be very high. Okay, very very high. See, it's very high. All right, let's see the situation of pressure loss in a vertical and a horizontal well. All right, okay, now let's compare a vertical well and a horizontal well. All right, now here I have compared the pressure loss that occurs between a vertical well and a horizontal well. In a vertical well, we can very well say that in the tubing part again, let me draw a schematic over here. There is a perforation. Okay, this is the reservoir, this is a vertical well. Okay, the elevation losses are very high. Okay, as compared to that of a friction loss. Okay, now similarly for a horizontal well, let's say if there is an horizontal well, okay, over here the friction losses will dominate as compared to that of a elevation loss, because as we know, the fluid, let's say this is a fluid, in a horizontal well the fluid will remain in the low side of the well. Okay, because of the gravity, the fluid will tend to be resting at the low side of the well. Okay, as a result, there would be friction that is acting in the opposite direction. Okay, because of this friction, there will be additional pressure losses. Okay, so this is a very beautiful comparison of a vertical well and horizontal well, the comparison of pressure losses that occur in a vertical well or an horizontal well, and also we are comparing how this elevation pressure loss and friction pressure loss changes in different condition. All right, now coming to the next slide, which is nodal analysis. Now the definition of nodal analysis is to combine the various components of the production system of an individual well to estimate Q, that is the flow rate, and optimize each component. Okay, this is the definition of a nodal analysis. Okay, the amount of oil and gas produced from the reservoir to the surface depends on the pressure drop in the production system, and the pressure drop in the system depends on the amount of fluid flowing through the system. Consequently, the entire production system must be analyzed as a unit or a system. Okay, whenever we are performing nodal analysis, we are assuming that the entire system is a single unit. Okay, that means if we need to optimize any point, for example, if we need to optimize let's say the bottom hole, okay, bottom hole of a well, okay, then we have to take into consideration each and every point. That is, we have to take into consideration reservoir, we have to definitely take into consideration the bottom hole, we have to take into consideration tubing, well head, flow line, and also the separator. Okay, so that's the significance of this point. We are considering the entire unit, entire production system, as a single unit or as a single system. Okay, this particular system analysis or the nodal analysis works on the concept of continuity. All right, if there is any change in the system, then there will be an associated change in pressure and or production rate at that same point. Okay, if there is any sort of disturbance in any system, let's say if there is disturbance in the bottom hole, then definitely there would be disturbances visible at other system also. Okay, if there is if there is any sort of disturbance at the bottom hole, then you can also see some sort of disturbance in the wellhead. That means the tubing head pressure might change, or the casing head pressure, mainly the tubing head pressure might change, or else we can also see some sort of disturbance in the separator side also. Okay, in the surface side also we can see the disturbance. Okay, This concept allows the production system to be divided into at a point of interest for evaluation of the two portion of the system. These points are called nodes. Okay, we will take this thing in detail. Okay, we will discuss nodes. What are nodes? Okay. Okay. The components upstream of the division point comprises of the inflow section, and the components downstream of the node represents the outflow section. All right. Done. Now, flow rate and the pressure at the node can be calculated by this particular thing. Okay, the flow rate and the pressure can be calculated by the flow into the node equals flow out of the node. Okay, we are taking the assumption. These are the two assumptions that we'll take while calculating the flow rate and pressure at a particular node. Okay, first thing is whatever flow is coming into the node will go out of the node, and second point is only one pressure exists at a particular node. Okay, so these are the two assumptions that we take while we are calculating the flow rate and pressure at a particular node. All right. Now let's see what a node is. Okay, I will explain how the node works. Okay, now let me consider this particular point as a node. Okay, this is my node. Okay, this bottom hole pressure, this bottom hole of the well bore is my node over here. Okay, node is equal to bottom hole. All right, now I have taken this as constant. Now pressure at node, that is PWF, pressure at node, what does this mean? How to calculate the pressure at this point, that is at the node PWF? As we all know, the this is the upstream of my node, and these are my downstream of the node. Okay, now for upstream part, for the upstream part, if we need to calculate what's the pressure at that particular node, then it would be PR, that is this one, reservoir pressure, minus the delta P. Okay, minus the pressure drop, this pressure drop delta P, this delta P, all right, minus the delta P across the reservoir. If we are subtracting the reservoir pressure minus the delta P across the reservoir, then you can get the node. Okay, now let's address the downstreams. Now let's address the downstream side also. Now how to calculate PWF by addressing the downstream side? Let's see. PWF equal to pressure loss in the tubing. Okay, delta P tubing plus, now we have to add. Okay, delta P in the tubing plus delta P in the surface. Okay, I'm considering in the entire thing, entire surface. Okay, that is from the wellhead to the choke to the flow line. Okay, that means delta P tubing plus delta P surface plus my separator pressure. Okay, my separator will be held at some particular pressure. All right. Huh. So this, that is the upstream side, I obtain PWF is equal to this much by subtracting reservoir pressure and delta P that occurs across the reservoir and the completion. And from the downstream side, to calculate this particular, this same thing, PWF, we can also calculate PWF from the downstream by considering the downstream components, and it turns out to be PWF is equal to delta P that occurs in the tubing plus delta P that occurs at the surface plus P separator. All right. So that's the concept of node. Now let's discuss inflow performance, IPR. It is a mathematical tool used in production engineering which represents the ability of the reservoir to provide the reservoir fluids into the wellbore for a given pressure drop between the reservoir and the wellbore. Okay, now let me draw a schematic of a wellbore over here. Okay, this is schematic, these are the perforation. Okay, now what does this definition mean? Reservoir se wellbore mein jaane ke liye. ठीक है, सो व्हाट डस आईपी, सो इन अदर वर्ड्स आईपीआर कैन बी सेड एज एक रिजर्वॉर, जो रिजर्वॉर फ्लूइड है उसको कितनी अच्छी तरीके से वेलबोर में डाल पा रहा है, ठीक है, इन इन द कंडीशन ऑफ आईपीआर. नाउ आईपीआर गिव्स द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन द सरफेस फ्लो रेट एंड द फ्लोइंग वाटर मोल प्रेशर. ठीक है, नाउ व्हेन वी आर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट आईपीआर वी नीड टू एड्रेस दिस पीआई, ओके, प्रोडक्टिविटी इंडेक्स ऑल्सो. नाउ प्रोडक्टिविटी इंडेक्स और कॉमनली नोन एज वेल डिलीवरेबिलिटी, ओके, इट इज द रेशियो ऑफ यूनिट ड्रॉडाउन, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट, इट इज द रेशियो ऑफ फ्लो रेट, इट इज द रेशियो ऑफ फ्लो रेट टू अ यूनिट ड्रॉडाउन. दिस ड्रॉडाउन, यूनिट ड्रॉडाउन इज बिटवीन द रिजर्वर एंड द वेलबोर एंड दैट टू एट अ स्टेबिलाइज्ड प्रोड्यूसिंग कंडीशन. ठीक है, वेरी सिंपल, बट वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड वॉट द डेफिनेशन मीन्स. ओके, इट इज द रेशियो ऑफ फ्लो रेट टू द यूनिट ड्रॉडाउन दैट वी आर गिविंग बिटवीन द रिजर्वर एंड द वेलबोर एंड एट विच कंडीशन, एट द स्टेबल कंडीशन. ओके, एट दैट पॉइंट वॉट एवर वी आर गेटिंग इट इज द पी आई ऑफ अ वेल. ओके, नाउ दिस पी आई इज मेजर्ड वेल वाइज, दैट इज ईच एंड एवरी वेल विल हैव सम डिफरेंट पी आई. ऑल राइट, सो दैट इज पी आई. सो इट इज द एबिलिटी ऑफ द वेल टू प्रोड्यूस फ्लूइड इन टू द, सो पी आई इज Q by delta P, where delta P is PR minus PWF. Okay. Now, as we all know, Q is directly proportional to PR minus PWF. If we are considering that, we are putting some sort of constant K. Now, K is equal to Q by delta P. This K is known as PI. It's a very simple thing. Okay. What does this? Now let's look at this particular graph. Very important graph. All right. So this is a graph between flowing bottom hole pressure PWF and liquid rate QL. Okay. Now, when we so this is the straight line that we obtained. This point AOF is a very crucial point as far as production engineering is concerned. AOF means absolute open flow. Okay. So what does this mean? It is the maximum flow rate obtained when a well has a zero sand phase back pressure. Okay. When the well has a zero back pressure, at that point, whatever at this point, that means at zero back pressure at the sand phase, you will get the maximum amount of flow in the wellbore. Okay, that means the maximum capacity. How much? मतलब ये कोई आपको पूछे कि एक well का maximum capacity क्या है? तो आप बोल सकते हो कि वो मेरा AOF है, दैट इज वो मेरा एब्सोल्यूट ओपन फ्लो पोटेंशियल है. नाउ लेट्स डिस्कस स्पेसिफिक पीआई. ओके, नाउ दिस स्पेसिफिक, नाउ व्हेन वी डिवाइड द पीआई विद द नेट पे थिकनेस, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टर्म, ओके, विद नेट पे, नॉट ग्रॉस पे, ओके, और नॉट द हाइट ऑफ द रिजर्वॉयर, बट व्हेन वी डिवाइड द पीआई विद द नेट pay thickness, okay, at that time whatever we are getting it is known as specific PI. And let's say there are assume that there are 100 wells in a well, this is a reservoir, assume this is a reservoir, okay, let's say there are 100 wells. Okay, now let's say if I'm asking you ki ye 100 well mein se which well is the best, okay, so how can you say which one is the best? Okay, at that time this concept of specific PI comes into play. All right, now at that time what you will do, you will find out the specific PI of each and every well, okay, and whichever well has the best specific PI, for that well you can say that ha ye particular well hamara sabse best hai ye reservoir mein. Theek hai, so that's, so this specific PI it can be used to compare different wells in a field. ठीक है, एक well में, एक field में अगर आपको wells को compare करना है तो हमेशा specific PI के terms में ही हम बात करेंगे. Alright? ठीक है, sorry. Now, so I have So this particular graph shows the typical performance for a solution gas drive reservoir. Okay, now you can see that this is a plot of the different parameters on the y-axis and cumulative production or time. Okay, or time. Okay. With time, you can see that for a solution gas drive reservoir, for a solution gas drive reservoir, the PI will decrease with time. All right. You can also see that with time the reservoir pressure also will go down. With time the GOR is increasing. It will increase since it is a solution gas drive. It will increase and at this point it will again go down. Okay. Now let's see for gas cap drive also. You can see here for a gas cap drive also with time, with that is cumulative production or versus time, with time the PI will go down. Okay, because over here the pressure is also going down, and for a gas cap the GOR will rise with time. Okay, for a strong water drive reservoir, you can see that PI will remain almost the same. Why? Because the pressure is being maintained the same. Okay, in the previous example when we were talking about solution gas drive or the gas cap drive, there the reservoir pressure was also declining with time. Okay, but since we are talking about a strong water drive reservoir, okay, let's say this is the oil bank and there is huge amount of aquifer support. Okay, there is huge amount of aquifer support. Okay, because of this huge amount of aquifer, the reservoir pressure will remain constant in this particular field. Okay, so since our reservoir pressure is maintained, that is remaining constant, our PI will also remain constant throughout the life of the well. Okay, got it? Okay, now let's see what we have in the next slide. Okay. Over here also you can see that I have compared PI with cumulative recovery. This cumulative recovery can also be termed as time. Okay, I have compared various PI with time. So over here you can see here for each and it has been assumed that for each and every well this is the saturation pressure. Okay, as I mentioned before, for water drive the PI will remain almost constant. For gas cap, see the trend of PI, and look at solution drive. Look at the trend of it will go down very drastically in solution gas drive. Okay, again, what's the reason? The reason is for water drive, the reservoir pressure over here, reservoir pressure plays a huge role. Okay, for a water drive, the reservoir pressure remains constant almost throughout the life of the reservoir, but it's not the case for a gas cap or a solution gas drive. Okay. Now let's compare inflow curves for different drive mechanism. Okay, see, this is the IPR curve. Okay, whatever we plot between PWF and Q, it is known as IPR. We have discussed this. Now there are three wells, well A, B and C. All the three wells are in different fields, and each field have different reservoir drive mechanism. Okay, well A lies in the reservoir with water drive, well B lies in the reservoir with gas cap drive, and well C lies in the reservoir with solution gas drive. Okay, now this graph very beautifully explains how the IPR at a particular time, if you are comparing IPR, this graph very nicely explains us. Okay, I think I don't have to explain this particular thing. Here for water drive, since PI is constant, the graph is straight. Since as we all know, PI is the slope obtained by Q by delta P. Okay, this is the slope. Okay, PI is obtained from this slope. Okay, PI is this slope. Okay, so for water drive, this PI is constant, so the slope has hardly changed. But for a gas cap drive, there is a change in slope. We will discuss it when we discuss Vogel relation. For well C also, for a solution gas also, this particular, there is the slope is continuously changing with time, and the PI is also going down with time. Okay, now let's go to the next slide. Okay, now before going to the Vogel relation or standing relation, let us discuss about reservoir deliverability. Okay, now this reservoir deliverability depends on several factors, which includes reservoir pressure, pay zone thickness and permeability, reservoir boundary type and distance, wellbore radius, reservoir fluid properties, near wellbore conditions, and the reservoir relative permeability. Okay, so this is the Darcy, this is the equation. Okay, modified Darcy equation, where KH is PE minus PW, P is the reservoir pressure or the stable or the average reservoir pressure, PW is the flowing bottom pressure, RE is the reservoir radius, RW is the wellbore radius, and S is the skin. Okay. Now we need to address skin. Okay. As we all know, skin is a region of altered permeability near the wellbore. Okay. Now, I have magnified this image over here. Okay. Now, this is the near wellbore. This shaded region is the near wellbore region. Okay. Now, as we all know, the fluid's journey begin with pressure of PR. Okay. Now, as it is flowing through the porous media, the reservoir pressure is going down. Okay. At this particular point. Okay. If at this particular point, let's assume that if it was an undamaged reservoir, okay, if the near wellbore didn't have any sort of altered permeability, then it should have followed this particular pressure trend. Okay, but because of altered permeability, now it has begun to follow this particular trend. Okay, that means there is an additional pressure drop. There is this additional pressure drop delta PD. Okay, because there is some sort of damage near the in the near wellbore region. Okay, so this is for a damaged near wellbore region. Okay, now let's see if we had stimulated this particular near wellbore, then at that point the delta P would be reduced. See, if it were a stimulated well, then delta P would have been less. Okay, that means for actual it would have been P2, but for a stimulated well there would be a negative delta P. Okay, we will discuss it in the next slide. Now before going discussing about skin in detail, we need to address this particular thing also, which is pressure profile in a constant pressure support boundary, and pressure profile in a no flow boundary. Okay. Okay, now let's discuss two cases. It's case one, where it is a confined reservoir, and it's case two, where there is infinite support. Okay, assume both are a rectangular reservoir, and there is one well in the center of the reservoir. Okay, now in this case over here there is confined and there is no any support from the boundary. Okay, there is no support from the boundary, that means there is no aquifer at the boundary. And in this case, in case 2, there is infinite support. Okay, in the boundary. All right. So this particular system can be true for a dp by dt equal to constant, that is for pseudo steady state condition. For pseudo steady state condition, this particular case will be satisfied. That means at a particular time, let's say at the rate time t1, okay, at each and every point in the reservoir, the pressure, reservoir pressure will remain the same. At, let's say at t1, at each and every point in the reservoir, the reservoir pressure will remain p1, and let's say time t2, at each and every point in the reservoir, my pressure will be p2. Okay, but with time we know the pressure will decline, but the rate of decline, that is dp by dt, will remain constant. Okay, that's pseudo steady state condition. Whereas in this case, since we have an infinite support from the aquifer, over here with time the reservoir pressure is not changing, that is dp by dt equal to zero. So the reservoir pressure will remain the same throughout the life of the well. Now let's come to Vogel's IPR. This particular IPR is applicable for a saturated reservoir only. For a saturated reservoir, that is when reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point pressure, at that time only this Vogel's IPR is applicable. Okay, now let's look at the theory. For a single phase, as we all know, IPR is a straight line because PI will remain constant above the bubble point pressure, and below bubble point the PI will decrease due to changes in phase behavior, rel pump, oil viscosity and flow, and FVF, that is formation volume factor. We will discuss it, we will discuss this in detail. Now let's see over here. As we can see that over here, this is the bubble point pressure. This is a plot of pressure versus flow rate. This is a plot of pressure versus flow rate. Here PI indicates the initial reservoir pressure, the initial pressure in the system. Over here it is the reservoir pressure. PB indicates bubble point pressure. Okay. Now, as we all can see that above the bubble point, the slope of this particular graph will remain the same. Okay, that means the PI, as we all know, PI is the slope of Q by delta P. Alright. So above bubble point, PI will remain the same, but below bubble point there is this fluctuation observed. Okay, and why this fluctuation is observed? It is because of these four reasons: phase behavior, rel pump, oil viscosity, and formation volume factor. Okay. Now let's come to this particular graph. So here point A is for a straight line IPR for undersaturated point, okay, and point B is for a Vogel one. Okay, this graph is for Vogel. Okay, again Vogel is applicable below the bubble point only, and points is the combination of both A and B. Okay, okay, at this point, from this point, what they did is that they combined both undersaturated and the saturated condition to obtain this particular graph, right? It's a very simple graph, nothing much. Now coming to this part, how the PI changes, let's discuss this in detail. Okay, now this is a phase diagram of a typical well. Okay, phase diagram of a typical well. Okay, over here the reservoir pressure, point A, at point A the reservoir pressure is pressure and temperature is PR and TR. Okay, at the wellbore it is represented by PWF and TWF, and same. Again, one thing to be observed is that from the reservoir to wellbore, it is assumed to have an isothermal condition. Okay, isothermal. The temperature of the reservoir is constant. Temperature of the reservoir is assumed to be constant, but from the wellbore, that is from the bottom hole to this separator part, you can see that both pressure as well as the temperature is going down, and at this point you will get your reservoir separator pressure and separator temperature. Okay, you know that if there is any sort of change in the reservoir, then only the PI will change. Okay, now so we will focus on this part only. Okay, that is from reservoir to wellbore part. This is where the PI gets disturbed. Okay, now what happens? What happened is as the for an undersaturated reservoir, okay, for an undersaturated reservoir, as the reservoir pressure is going below, okay, at that time the gas that is present in the oil, it will try to liberate out, but since it has not reached the saturation pressure, the gas, instead of getting liberated out, what it will do is that it will try to expand the oil, okay, it will try to swell the oil. Okay, once the reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point, at that point, from that point the gas will start to liberate in the reservoir. Okay, that's, I think that's the definition of bubble point pressure also. Okay, the pressure at which the first bubble of gas is liberated. Okay, that's the definition of a bubble point pressure. Okay, now phase diagram. Okay, now let me plot a bell for you. Let me draw a schematic of bell for you. Okay, now there is PR, there is PWF. Okay, okay, now assume your reservoir pressure is 2000 psi. Okay, and your bubble point is at 1500 psi. Now let's say your PWF is at, let's say, 1800 psi, that is above bubble point. Okay, at this point, okay, above bubble point, your PWF is above bubble point. That means there is no gas being liberated in the reservoir. Okay, when the while the fluid flows from this point to this point, since PWF is above the bubble point pressure, there is no gas liberated. Alright, and the instead the oil will try to swell because it has not reached to the bubble point pressure. And once it crosses the bottom hole and reaches the tubing, and that point the bubbles will start to develop, because definitely it would have gone below the pressure of the fluid will have definitely gone below the saturation pressure of the fluid. Alright, so this is for one case. Let's say I have a reservoir, same case, for reservoir pressure of 2000 psi, bubble point of 1500 psi, and let's say PWF at this point is 1200. Alright, okay, now PWF is 1200. Now since it is this particular case is for a saturated reservoir, okay, this particular is for a saturated reservoir, and since PWF is below bubble point pressure, over here what happens is that within the reservoir itself the gas will start to liberate. All right, reservoir may he liberate over, but in this particular case, that is this one that was for undersaturated reservoir, mein koi gas nahi aa raha tha, rather jab wo fluid tubing ke through ja raha tha us time pe gas liberate hona start hua tha. Okay, but in saturated reservoir the gas has started to liberate in the reservoir itself. All right, okay, so this is all about the phase diagram. Now let's discuss about the rel pump. Second thing, that is rel pump, let's discuss about this thing. All right, now let's say my reservoir is a saturated reservoir. I'm talking about a saturated reservoir. Okay, in saturated reservoir, as the gas starts liberating in the reservoir, the gas has a particular property that once it starts to liberate, then it tries to occupy the maximum amount of pore space. Okay, that, okay, and since it occupies maximum amount of pore space, it will drastically reduce the fluid flow. Okay, it will drastically reduce the, sorry, liquid flow, not fluid. It will drastically, since the gas has started liberating and since it has started occupying the pore spaces in the reservoir, that is in the porous media, now the liquid flow will be drastically reduced. All right, now you can see from this particular plot itself, the gas has begun to flow. At that time there is a drastic reduction in oil. See, okay, there's a drastic reduction in the oil. Okay, I think I hope you all have got it. And this is the crossover point. Okay, it's about the third point, which is oil viscosity. Now we know the let me plot viscosity of oil versus pressure. Okay, this is the trend that we obtained for oil viscosity. Okay, again, this is my bubble point pressure, and we will be discussing our fluid. We'll take the journey from the reservoir pressure. Let's say this is my initial reservoir pressure. This point is my initial reservoir pressure. And my fluid will take the journey from this point to this point, right? Now I'm discussing this particular case in the reservoir condition only, right? Now as we can see that as I'm reducing the pressure, reservoir pressure, from the initial to the bubble point, my viscosity is reducing. Okay, and once the reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point, my viscosity has started to climb up again. Okay, the reason is, again, as I mentioned, above the bubble point pressure, the gas is not able to come out of the oil. Instead of coming out of the oil, it is expanding. Okay, it is trying to swell the oil. All right, because of that phenomena, since the oil gets swelled above the bubble point, you can see there is a reduction in viscosity. Okay, now once the reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point, now the oil, the gas has started to liberate from the oil, and you can see that there is now, with further reduction in pressure, the viscosity of the oil has started to increase, because the lighter component present in the crude oil has now started getting liberated, and because of that, heavier components is left behind, and as a result, the viscosity is increasing with reduction in pressure. Okay, now again, there's a good trivia point. If someone asks you which is the best time for water flooding project, then this particular point is the best time for water flooding project. Okay, this is the best time for a water flooding project, because as we all know, the mobility ratio, okay, it is displacing phase to the displaced phase. At this point, the mobility ratio would be the least. Okay, into the fourth point, that is our oil formation volume factor. FVF, or commonly known as BO versus pressure. Okay, the trend will be somewhat like this. This is my bubble point pressure. Okay, so the journey will be like this. As we are reducing the pressure, this is how it will be recorded. As we all know, the unit is reservoir barrel to the stock tank. All right, now we can see that, and now in the undersaturated region, there is this particular region that is above bubble point, my oil FVF is increasing with reduction in pressure. Okay, once it goes below the bubble point pressure, my oil formation volume factor is reducing as I am reducing the pressure. Okay, why? Again, the same reason, above the bubble point, my oil starts to swell as I am reducing the pressure, and below the bubble point, the oil, the gas is now getting liberated from the oil. The equation given by Vogel, and it is only applicable for when reservoir pressure is below the bubble point pressure. Right, now these are all the assumptions that it took. I don't think it is that important for us to understand the derivation as of now, because in GATE there will be no derivation being asked, only the direct application will be asked over here. Okay, what it did is that he considered that below bubble point there would not be a straight line, that is IPR will not be a straight line, and instead he came out with a parabolic equation. Okay, he distributed the ratio of PWF by PR as 20% of PWF upon PR and 80% of PWF upon PR the whole square. Okay, means he would have conducted various experiments, and from that he would have got this particular equation. Okay, and this is the equation that he come up with. Now let's discuss the extension of Vogel's IPR for damaged or improved well. Okay, the initial Vogel that was given by the initial IPR relation that was given by Vogel, it was for a well with zero skin. Now we will be discussing extension of Vogel's IPR. Okay, now for a damaged well or an improved well. Okay, in this again the equation will remain the same. Only difference is that instead of PWF, a PWF dash term has been introduced. Okay, now let's see what does this mean. Okay, before getting into this, we should understand what is flow efficiency. Flow efficiency is the ratio of actual drawdown to the ideal drawdown. Okay, by PR minus PWF dash divided by PR minus PWF. Okay, as we all know, this PWF dash, it is the summation of PWF plus the delta P skin. Okay, from that I am just placing this PWF F dash over here and getting FPS this thing. Okay, from that I can derive PWF F dash by PWF PR as 1 minus FE plus FE into PWF by PR. From that I can get this Q by Q max is equal to 1 minus 0.2, this same equation. All right, there is another term which is damage ratio. This is DR, and it is the reciprocal of flow efficiency, 1 by FE. Oh, alright. Sometimes this question can also be asked in GATE. Let's understand what skin is. Skin is a region of altered permeability, okay, near the wellbore region. Okay, now in this particular diagram, RW is my wellbore radius. RW is my wellbore radius and RS is the region of my this particular is my region of near wellbore where I have obtained skin, where I can observe an altered permeability. Okay, altered permeability means this KS. Okay, permeability due to skin, this is my altered permeability and that is found only near the wellbore, and the original permeability is K. Okay, which is the reservoir permeability is K. Okay, now this thing, this particular thing, actually we have got from Horner's plot. Horner's plot from build up well testing. Okay, now whenever we will discuss well testing, at that time I think we will put up this, we will explain it in more detail. Now as of now, just remember that delta P skin is equal to 0.87 of ms, where m is the slope obtained. See, this is the build up Horner's plot. This m is the slope obtained from this particular curve. Okay, from this 162.6 I am putting this over here. Okay, 0.87 into m into s, from that I am getting 141.2 into q mu b upon kh into s. Okay, as we all know, for skin greater than 0, my delta p skin would be greater than 0, and for skin less than 0, my delta p skin would be less than 0. Okay, now what is delta P? That what is the pressure drop across the skin? To find that, we have to find the delta P, that is the pressure drop in the skin zone due to permeability of the skin, minus the pressure drop in the skin zone due to the original permeability. Okay, now to obtain delta P skin, you just have to put this formula where this per K we are replacing, wherever K skin is there, we are replacing with it with case permeability of skin, and wherever the original permeability is there, we are keeping it as K only. All right, that you can get this particular, there is a equation of delta P skin, that is 141.2 q mu b upon k into k by k skin minus 1 into ln of r skin upon rw. All right, from this thing we can get, if we are separating out this particular thing, then this is my formula of skin, s is equal to k by k skin minus 1 ln R skin upon RW. This is also known as Hawking formula, if I'm not wrong. This is the Hawking formula. Alright. Now, as you all know, as I discussed it before, delta P actual is equal to delta P ideal plus delta P skin. Delta P actual means PR minus PWF dash upon equal to PR minus PWF, which is the ideal skin, plus delta P skin. And from that, I got this PWF dash is equal to PWF plus delta P skin. Okay. Again, I repeated the same coefficients is actual drawdown upon ideal drawdown. Explain new skin in a different manner. Okay. Let's say I am getting some flow rate of 200 barrels of liquid per day at the rate of, let's say, when I'm giving a delta P of, let's say, I'm giving a delta P of 100 PSI. That is delta P, that is pressure difference between the reservoir and the wellbore. If I'm giving, let's say, 100 PSI, and for every 100 PSI, I'm getting a flow rate of 200 barrel per day. Okay. Let's say this is for a case where skin is zero. There is no skin in my reservoir near the wellbore. Okay. There is no skin near the wellbore in this particular case. For giving a delta P of 100 PSI, I'm getting flow rate. Just assume. Okay, I'm just explaining a case. Now, let's say now there is a skin greater than zero. Okay. Now, to get this same 200 barrels of liquid, now because I have a skin, now I will have to give a delta P greater than 100 PSI. Let's say I now have to give 120 PSI. Okay, that means over here I am giving a drawdown of 20 PSI more to get that same flow rate. Okay, I'm just trying to explain you in a different manner. Okay, now let's see if there is a skin less than zero. Now for this particular case, now if you want to have a flow rate of 200 again, now I will require a pressure drop of only 80 PSI. Okay, now itna jyada pressure drop nahi chahiye. Okay, because now my skin is less than zero. That means now I am talking about a stimulated well. And for a stimulated well, to produce that same 200 barrels of liquid, now I have to give comparatively lesser delta P. Okay, this delta P, again, this thing can be seen. That is delta P actual equal to delta P ideal plus delta P skin. Okay. We know this. Now, these things that I'm discussing, that is 80 is my delta P actual. Let's say for this case, delta P actual is 80. My ideal case was 100. That is for skin equal to 0. This was my ideal case. Now let's talk about Fedkovich IPR, the info performance relationship given by Fedkovich. Now, what it did was, according to him, oil well having a reservoir pressure below the bubble point also behaves like a gas well. Okay, so the IPR equation being used for gas wells will be applicable for oil wells also. This was his assumption. Okay, so he had given this particular equation for gas wells, that is Q is equal to C PR square minus PF square. Okay, where C is the performance coefficient, or this is also known as flow coefficient also. Both are one and the same, performance coefficient and flow coefficient, and C, and where N is the flow coefficient. Okay. And for oil wells, he had obtained this particular equation, Q by Q max is equal to 1 minus PF upon PR the whole square. Okay. Now, how did he get this equation? As we all know, you will obtain Q max, again the definition of absolute open flow potential, when I am giving a PWF equal to 0, at that time whatever I am getting is my maximum, that is whatever I am obtaining is my Q max. Okay, now if I am giving PWF equal to 0, okay, that means I am just putting this over here, that means Q max equal to C into PR square. Okay, so this is my equation 1, this is my equation 2. Now I am dividing equation 1 by 2. if I'm dividing that, I will get Q by Q max is equal to 1 minus PWF by PR the whole square. Okay, this is what I this is how I will get this particular equation. All right. Now let's discuss for gas wells. For gas wells, whenever we have two test point data, at that time we can use this Rollins and Schellhead method, and second is John, Blount and Glaze method. Okay. Now for Rollins and Schellhead method, you use the same Fedkovich formula. Okay. Where C is the flow coefficient, N is the flow exponent. Okay. What it did is that it took log on both the sides and got a straight line equation. Okay. This is the plot of log QG versus log PR square minus PF square. Okay. From that you will get a straight line. The slope obtained from this straight line would be the flow exponent, and the intercept obtained from the straight line would be the log of flow coefficient. Okay. So this particular thing is applicable when there are two test point data of a gas well. Now coming to John Blount Glaze method, over here again this is applicable for two test points. Okay, over here what he did is that he used this quadratic equation for you use the funda of quadratic equation that is ax square plus bx plus c. Okay, and he found by using this he got the root of the equation. By using this particular thing, he got this particular he got this equation. According to him, this thing PR square minus PF square equal to A into QG plus B the QG square. Okay, this is how the quadratic equation will look like. Now he took QG down. Okay, he took the value of QG in the denominator on both the sides, and he obtained this particular thing. Now this is a straight line. Okay, now this is a straight line. If now plotting PR square minus PF square upon QG versus QG, now you will obtain a straight line over here. Okay, and the intercept would be A, which is the degree of damage, which indicates the degree of damage, and the slope B that you are obtaining, it is the turbulence, the coefficient which is obtained, which is there because of turbulence. Okay, now from this particular equation, if you want to find the flow rate, then you can use the that same funda that we use for getting the roots out of a quadratic equation. The same funda can be used over here to get the flow rate of gas. Now this is again a very good concept, where in this if you have a single test point, at that time we can use this particular concept. Okay, now over here for a gas well there are three regions that has been differentiated. Region 1, which in which the reservoir pressure lies between 0 to 2000 psi. In region 2, where the pressure lies between 2000 to 3000 psi. And in region 3, where the reservoir pressure lies above 3000 psi. Okay. Now, for all the three different regions, to get the flow rate, you have different equations. Like in region 3, you will use this particular formula. Okay, and it is almost similar. You can observe that this almost the equation is almost similar to that of an oil well. Okay, that means there is no square or pseudo function being used. In region 2 you use a pseudo function psi. Okay, this value, this pseudo function is used, and this basically this pseudo pressure is a mathematical pressure function that accounts for the variable of z and viscosity of gas with respect to pressure. Okay, this pseudo pressure, what does it do is that, see, prove this over here. Okay, it takes into account pressure with changing in viscosity and z value. Okay, now the pseudo pressure function is two times p by mu z, where it has been integrated from 0 to p, and from that you can obtain that pseudo function of p can also be written as pi square minus p naught square upon mu z. Alright, a pressure squared method is used to calculate the gas flow rate. Alright, now why do we require this particular thing, that is why only for a gas well we are having these three different equations. Okay, for that, as we know, for an oil the value of z, viscosity and density do not change significantly. Okay, this is very important term. It will change. ऐसा नहीं कि change नहीं होता, change तो होता है, but significant change नहीं मिलेगा. Okay, with changing pressure for an oil well, value of z or viscosity or density ज़्यादा significantly change नहीं होता. But in comparison for a gas well, the value of z, viscosity and density changes very significantly. All right, and because of this thing, only at lower pressures. Okay, at higher pressures, it almost behaves like an oil well. That's not an issue. But at lower pressures, when the reservoir pressure is low, that is less than 3000 psi, at that time we need to, if it lies between 2000 to 3000 psi, at that time we need to put up a pseudo pressure function. And for if the pressure is below 2000 psi, at that point we need to put up pressure squared function to calculate the gas flow rate. All right. Now let's understand what's the future IPR given by Standing. Okay. Now as we all know, this by Q, this is P by Q. Okay. Let's say this is an IPR that I obtained 5 years back. This is my IPR that I obtained 5 years back. Okay. Now if I'm constructing IPR for this same well, the IPR would have gone down. Okay. And so this is this is for 5 years back and this is today. Now if I want to predict what will be in the IPR after 5 years. Okay. Now by using this particular concept, we can also predict what will be in the IPR after 5 years. All right. Now, Standing gave this particular future IPR concept. Okay. Now what he did is that first he rearranged the Vogel equation. This is Vogel equation only, but he rearranged it. All right. Now substituting the expression for the productivity index. Now he substituted this, as we know, the Q max. As we all know, the J is equal to Q by PR minus PWF. He substituted this particular thing, and he got in this particular equation, and he got this. Okay. Now Standing then defined a zero drawdown productivity index as J star by giving the limit PWF to PR. Okay. PWF is almost tending to PR. He gave the limit of PWF almost tending to PR, and for that he got J is equal to 1.8 Q max. Okay. What he did in this case is that he assumed that PWF is almost same to PR. Then he, by doing that, he is able to cut this particular equation. Now he is getting 1.8 of Q max upon PR equal to J. Okay, this is how we got this particular thing. Q max is equal to J star PR upon 1.8. All right. Now, if the change in J star with depletion can be predicted, then the change of Qmax can be calculated. Okay. Now for J star, that is, now to get J star, this is again what he did is that he just put a function of pressure over here. Okay. From that, this function of pressure, only term that will change with time. Okay. Because of this function of pressure, that is because of rel pump, viscosity and all FPF, because of this thing, your J will change, as we have discussed. When will the J change? Okay, we had seen phase behavior, we had seen wall viscosity, we had seen rel pump, and we had seen formation volume factor. Okay, so he introduced this particular function. Now the pressure function will change with depletion, since mu and B are function of pressure, and rel pump is also function of oil and gas saturation. Okay, the relationship between the present or real time J star and some future value of J star can be expressed as this particular thing. Okay, once you have this, we combined both to get the future and the real time IPR. All right, now this is the formula that we use whenever we solve a numerical. This is the formula that we use to find the future IPR using Standing relationship. Now coming to this future IPR given by Fetkovic. Again, this particular graph I had explained there. This is my current IPR. Okay. In the future, what would be the IPR? We can predict this by using Fetkovic also. He gave this particular equation. where q max at the future divided by q max in the present is equal to pr upon pr. Pr reservoir pressure in the future divided by reservoir pressure in the present into pr, pr into pr reservoir pressure in the future square upon pr in present square, and this entire thing is given in bracket. Okay, this particular thing, this square thing is given in n, it is whole square of n, and this n is the flow exponent. All right, this derivation, you can, for this derivation you can refer back central, it is given very nicely over there. Now let's discuss how this IPR changes with different condition. Okay, I have taken various condition like effect of depletion, effect of viscosity, effect of varying near wellbore permeability, effect of perforation density, effect of perforation diameter. All right, now let's see how does this particular thing work. For the first case where there is effect of depletion, now as we can see that as we, I am producing the field, my that is as I am increasing my recovery, my IPR will go down definitely, because as you all know, as I am producing, my reservoir pressure is also going down. Okay, with time reservoir pressure will also go down. Okay, so this graph shows how the effect of depletion occurs in an IPR curve. Second thing is effect of viscosity. Okay, now if there is higher viscous oil, then the Q max would be comparatively low as compared to that of a lower viscous oil. Okay, why? Because if I am having a high viscosity oil, the oil itself will have a high resistance to flow. Okay, that means if I'm comparing two reservoirs at same depth, okay, only the thing, same permeability, everything is same, only the oil viscosity is different. In that case, it is obvious that for higher viscosity oil, the reservoir with higher viscosity, in that particular reservoir, the well will have comparatively lower flow rate. Okay, because higher viscosity means higher resistance. Discuss effect of varying near wellbore permeability. Okay, so I have taken three different zones. Okay, let's say I am having a well. Okay, this particular reservoir has three different layers: layer A, layer B, layer C. Okay, and in all the three layers, let's say in the first layer the near wellbore permeability comes out to be 1 millidarcy. In the second layer, it is near wellbore permeability, I'm talking about near wellbore permeability. Okay, in the second layer the near wellbore permeability is 10 millidarcy, and in the third layer the near wellbore permeability is 100 millidarcy. Okay, so if I am trying to plot one IPR for all the three different zones, then I have to composite it, I have to merge all the three IPRs. Okay, now if I'm merging it, so you can see that for particular layer A, where my near wellbore permeability is 1 millidarcy, at that point IPR is very low as compared to that of layer C, where my near wellbore permeability is around 100 millidarcy. Okay, now whenever we are coming out with an IPR, a composite IPR of a well, now at that time we need to address the number of layers present, and also we need to address how the IPR changes in each layer. Okay, once we know how the IPR, how the trend of IPR is there for each individual layer, then only we can create an composite IPR. Now let's see how the effect of perforation density affects. As we all know, okay, this particular graph shows the effect of perforation density, where n1, n2, n3, n4 are the number of perforations involved. Okay, now you can very well see, as I am increasing the number of perforation in my well, my IPR is also increasing. Very simple. Since I am increasing the number of perforation, that means I am reducing the resistance to the flow. Okay, basically I am creating more number of flow path, okay, towards the wellbore. Okay, as a result, my IPR will also increase. Since I am increasing the number of perforations, okay, my flow will also increase. So this thing can be clearly reflected over here. My iPad is also going in the right side as I'm increasing my number of perforation. Now coming to the effect of perforation diameter. Now perforation diameter is also very crucial. Now as I'm increasing the perforation diameter, at that time also the resistance will be less for the fluid to flow, and that is also reflected in IPR. As I'm increasing the number of perforation diameter, my IPR is also moving to the right side. That means I'm getting more amount of flow.